everyone. Hi, Jord.
Hi, Phil. Good to have you by my side again. And good evening, Trev.
Good evening for both.
Great to have you on tonight. Thank you so much for joining us. So, as you saw from the title slide, Trevor's going to be sharing some thoughts and I think quite a personal reflection on Psalm 51. But before we hear some of Trev's thoughts, I'm just going to share with you our slide that we've been following through since we began this series. And we can see that we're still in book two of the Psalter. And when we read this, we'll see our Psalms titles pattern. This is a Psalm of David, quite a famous Psalm of David, actually. And we will also, I think, see, Phil, you mentioned we might see a bit of Zion mentioned. Mm-hmm. And I think we're definitely going to come across God's steadfast love as well. So before Trev shares some thoughts, we'll just read Psalm 51 together. And if I can just share it on my screen.
Psalm 51. To the choir master. The Psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you might maybe justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins. Blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God. O God of my salvation. And my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then will you delight in right sacrifices, in burnt offerings, in whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar.
thanks, Phil. So hand over to Trev now to share some thoughts on Psalm 51.
Good evening, everyone. Well, as we saw, this is entitled Psalms in Challenging Times. And this psalm indeed was a challenging time for David when Nathan the prophet came up to him and said, you know, look what you've done, David. You are this man that's broken God's word and God's commandments with his actions through Bathsheba, the wife of another man. But sometimes we can look at these psalms and it can be completely different to us because it may have a meaning in some other way to us individually, unique to us as persons. And I'd like to tell you my story because I don't come from a religious background. I didn't really believe in God. I was more of an atheist than anything. But things have changed over the course of time. And this was one of the incidents that have helped me through that course of time. Back in 1998, I had a heart attack and I was taken into the Queen Elizabeth, Sally Oak Hospital as it was then. And I had the heart attack on the treadmill and they were obviously pushing it very, very hard. And I saw this very young petite blonde who was controlling the apparatus. And she says, oh, it's going to be very tough from now on, Mr. Hansen. And boy, was it tough. And I said to her, well, whatever happens, don't try to prop me up. I'm an ex-rugby player. I'll be able to take a fall or two. But when it did happen, she had to put a chair on the treadmill and sit me down. But that's when it happened. And I was on the top of the surgeon's list for urgent appointments. And I said, well, how long is that list? He says, well, it'll be at least 6 months. So I was signed off work for a period of 6 months. And things got very difficult because after 6 months, you're no longer paid and you're only reduced to statutory sick pay. So times were difficult and I'd got four daughters and they were all worried, the youngest one being 13, about to be 13, and the eldest one 19, four teenage daughters. I think that's probably what gave me the heart attack, actually. what happened was that I'd been to Weight Watchers to try to shed some weight. And I walked through the door and the phone rang. And they said, Mr. Hansen? I said, yes. They said, oh, it's the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. It's the surgeon secretary. We can fit you in with a cancellation if you can pop into the hospital tomorrow. And I said, well, just give me 5 minutes. I'll ring my wife and see what she says. And I rang my wife and she said, yes, don't miss the opportunity. So I rang them back and said, yes, yes. They said, oh, we'll come in tomorrow afternoon, a Thursday afternoon, and we'll sort you out. And your operation will be on Friday, either morning or lunchtime-ish. So with that in mind, I went to the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. And you can imagine, I've had no time to prepare, and sometimes maybe that's not a bad thing, actually, rather than worrying about it overnight, endless nights. It's just the one night I had to worry about. Anyway, we got to the hospital in the afternoon and there were about 10 of us for that new induction that day. We all had our little beds in a very small ward and we were all about to be operated on. So I think one team was going to do four operations and the two other teams were going to do three operations between them. And we were all talking and chatting and one guy was in a really bad state. He'd been down to Papworth Hospital. And they'd said to him, there's nothing we can do. But he came to the Kiwi because the professor thought he might give him a chance of life. So he was a really urgent and serious case compared to mine. But nonetheless, you lie there and you feel very worried about what's going to happen that following day. You know, will you see your family again? Will I see my four daughters again? Difficult times. Will it have a serious consequences to my health afterwards? And we just don't know these things sometimes. And you do live in fear and trepidation, I think, sometimes about what will happen in the future. Anyway, I got to thinking on my bed and the surgeon came in and he said, oh, he says, you've had no time to prepare for this. I just run through the procedure. He says, tomorrow morning, when you wake up, they'll give you a couple of sedatives to keep you calm. and then they'll shave your chest because we're going to be working on your chest. And they'll clean you down and sterilize you. And then what we'll do then is we'll make an incision down your chest, and then we'll break open your rib cage so that we can get at your heart. Meanwhile, there'd be two other surgeons, one working on your left leg and one working on your right leg. And they'll be stripping out the veins, which they're going to be using to do your bypass cap, because you've got to have a triple bypass tomorrow. And also we'll remove the mammary artery that men obviously don't necessarily need. And we'll use that because that's really good arterial material. And we'll use that to bypass the worst of the grafts that we got to do. Okay, said me, yeah, that sounds fine. And he said, what we'll do is we'll actually stop the heart. And we'll push the blood through a machine that slows your heart rate down and cools the body down so that you don't need to breathe at such a rapid rate because you'll be cold. And he said, so you may wake up feeling a bit chilled after your sleep, he said, but it's nothing to be worried about. You'll gradually come round. And I said, right, okay, that sounds all very interesting. And then he says, we start the heart. After having finished the surgery, then we sew you back up and glue your bones back together, wire you up with stainless steel, and then we sew you back up. And then you'll be off to ITU, and then they'll bring you around slowly there. And I thought, well, great, okay. So thinking about all that was going to be done, I obviously felt a bit unnerved and a bit worried. The real reason was because my cousin, who was about 10 years older than me, he'd come in the November, this is January we're talking about, and in the November he'd come in for his operation. Similar thing, it runs in the family genetics. And he had a triple bypass, but after 4 days, they couldn't stop the bleeding, and sadly he died in the Queen Elizabeth.
Oh, wow.
And you know, when you bear that in mind, you sometimes think, you know, I hope God's going to watch over me. Anyway, so hours go by and I couldn't sleep, and I was restless and really, really worried. And my wife had brought my Bible in for me to read. So I thought, well, what's the reading for tomorrow? I wonder what the reading is for tomorrow. And I opened my Bible up for the reading for that particular day, the Friday. And it was Psalm 51.
Wow.
And I thought, oh, well, let's read what David got to say here. So we look now at Psalm 51, and let's look at what the writer's saying. So he's saying, have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. So how was God going to show his steadfast love to me? How could he let me know that he was there watching over me and keeping me? According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions, my illness. This is a sin of mankind, isn't it? Inevitably, we will all die. But God willing, those of us who believe will be resurrected. Verse 2, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. I'm thinking, well, hang on, that's what they're going to do tomorrow. They're going to wash me, get a nice lather up, shave all the hairs off my chest to make me nice and clean and shower me down. And I'll be getting ready. And then he says, verse 7, purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. And what they do is, before they start all this, they disinfect you down with iodine to kill all the germs over the body where you're going to be operated on, because it was all my upper body. And they would wash me down with this iodine to kill all the germs and infection that might be there. And I wouldn't say whiter than snow. I think I'm in a funny yellow colour, because that's what I did, does to you. But you can get the idea. I should be whiter than snow. I was probably a bit shocked about it. I was unconscious, by the way, at this moment. And then it says, let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. And I thought, well, that's exactly what's going to happen tomorrow. The surgeon's going to open me up and then cut down and break open my chest bones and open up the rib cage so that they can get at my heart to do what they call open heart surgery. Mm. And then perform bypass grafts on each of those three blocked arteries. Mm. And he then goes on to say, hide your face from my sins, blot out all mine iniquities. And then in verse 10, Create a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. And you think about that. Create a clean heart, O God. I thought, how amazing is that? Because that's exactly what they're going to do. My heart was fine, but the arteries going to it were full of fat, and they had to be cleansed out in that sense. And I really felt, well, this is God speaking to me at this moment in time. Because how does God speak to us? Well, God doesn't speak to us any longer through words or sounds, but he speaks to us through his Bible. And I find that this is the most important thing. When we have problems and difficulties, go to our Bibles, because that's the go-to for answers. You don't need Google. You need God through reading his word, the Bible. And that's where the real answers to life come from. And then he goes on to say, a bit lower down, verse 17, the sacrifices, God, are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Well, when you think about that, it's when you feel broken that you go to God. And it's because I was prepared to open God's word and read what he had to say that I found these comforting words here in the Bible. And I read this passage of scripture and I just felt so calm and reassured by the words that we've just been reading that I just folded my book away by the side of the bed and went fast asleep and woke up, of course, the following morning, ready for this procedure to come about. My wife was a sister in charge of the ITU many years ago before we started our family. And she knew exactly what was going to happen. And I think the time roughly was about 3 to 3.5 hours for the operation. But she was worried, obviously, about me bleeding. And so they rang Rosie and told her when I had gone down to the theatre, because she still had friends in the intensive care unit. And she rang in 3 hours later. Oh, he's not down yet, Rose. We'll give you a call. Another half an hour went by. Oh, he's not down yet, Rose. We'll give you a call. Another half hour. And, well, that went on. It was 5.5 hours, the operation, because they couldn't stop the bleeding. And I think, obviously, Rosie must have prayed at some point. And the phone rang. And they said, Trevor's coming out now. We've just been told that the bleeding stopped. So you can imagine how she must have felt at that moment. Yeah, so she came into the hospital, being a sister on the intensive care unit. She just came in, checked everything was okay, and then went back up, because we've got the four girls at home. Anyway, the following morning, I woke up, and I felt this striking of my hand. Someone was stroking my hand, and I heard a voice say, good morning, Trevor, it's dawn. And I managed to open my eye and look out the window, and it was pitch black. I thought, it's not dawn. And then she started talking to me. She said, Rosie's been in to see you. She says, he's checked all the numbers. You're okay. You're going to do well. And she'll be packing later when you've come round. But we've got to take the tube out your throat before you can speak. And her name was Dawn, and she was a friend of Rosemary's. After a day or so in the intensive care unit, I went back to the ward of 46 beds. And I was on the ward and not feeling well at all. I was struggling to breathe. They couldn't figure out why I was gasping for air so much. I could hardly walk about and struggled just to walk from my bed to the toilet. It was just too much. And my wife came in to see me, and I said to my wife that, you know, if this is the end result, I'd rather have not have come out of it and woken up in the kingdom rather than to suffer this for the rest of my life. And she said, oh, there must be some reason, she said. I'll check with the consultant. Anyway, no sooner she said that the consultant come round for his morning duties. And he sat down and my wife chatted to him, and she said, he was not like this before he had the operation. You know, what's gone wrong? He's struggling for breath, you know. And she said to him, have you done blood tests? Because he lost quite a lot of blood during the operation. And he checked through his notes. He says, oh, no, we haven't done that yet. And she said, well, that's probably a good thing. He said, yes, I'll get that action straight away. And then he left us and we talked on, and she then had to go back to work. So in the afternoon, my wife came in again after work to pop in to see me. And she was sat on the bed talking to me. And she said that there's a brother coming in today for the same operation that you had, a triple bypass. And I didn't know him, but I knew his wife. And no sooner had we mentioned these words that we saw them walking down the ward into the day room, which is just about 10 yards further down from my bed. And I said to my wife, well, I'm going to make a big effort to walk over and go and see them. And of course, I'm just wearing pajama top and pajama shorts, and all my chest is open with all my wound. And we walked over there. My wife helped me over. And I said, oh, don't worry. I'm not your consultant. I'm Brother Trevor Hansen. And I'd just come to have a chat with you because you're about to have the same operation that I had. And we just got talking and chatting because the wives knew each other. The parents were in the same meeting many years ago and doing catch-up, etc. And just then I saw the consultant coming around to do his evening round. So I walked over and got into my bed and left my wife and them talking and chatting. And he got to the guy in the next bed to me and he dismissed him and says, you can go now. You're fine. No problems. And off he went. And then he came and sat by me and he said, yes, he says, your wife is quite right. He said, we did a blood check and your red blood cells are half what they should be. So we'll give you a blood transfusion. That'll be either tonight or more likely tomorrow. And I said, oh, great. Well, that's a comfort to know. And he said, yes, he said, you'll get more oxygen into your system then and you'll feel an awful lot better. So I thought, well, great. That's something to look forward to. And he then left and went to the next guy. And no sooner had he left than a nurse came down and she started changing the bedclothes on the bed where the guy had just gone. And I said, oh, I said, who's coming in the next bed? And she said, oh, it's a Mr. Brown. I said, oh, great. That was the brother who we'd just been talking to. So when she'd made the bed and she told him where his bed was, they came over and we all sat together in the group. And I could see they were a bit apprehensive about what was about to happen. And so I related the story of me feeling in the same way. And I couldn't sleep and felt anxious. And I opened my Bible for the reading of the day of the operation. And lo, it was Psalm 51. And so we opened our Bibles up and we talked about Psalm 51, you know, the washing me, making me clean, and then breaking my bones apart and cleaning my heart and create a right spirit within me. And they were as amazed as I was when it had happened to me. I had a really good talk, and then the wives had to leave, and Chris and I carried on and talked and chatted about our experiences. It's quite amazing, really, when you think there's 46 beds on the ward and they have 10 new people in every day. The odds of Chris going to be in the adjacent bed to me was absolutely amazing, really. And I do think all these things point towards the hand of God working in our lives. Anyway, the following morning, they came round and said, we're going to start your blood transfusion. And Chris was taken away for his operation. Later in the evening, his wife came in to see him, and then she came round to the ward to see me. And she said how strengthened they felt that we could talk about the things that were happening. It gave them great comfort when we could all talk about Psalm 51 together. And they felt reassured by the way that things had happened to me, and I was able to reassure them. And later on, some years later, he came to remind me of the passage in the second book of Corinthians and chapter 1 and verse 3, where it says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. Amazing. Who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble, by the comfort whereof we ourselves are comforted of God. Do you know, what a wonderful application that I'd been comforted through God's word in reading Psalm 51.
And I was able to comfort my brother and sister in the same way that we talked about Psalm 51. And she'd come to say how comforting she felt and reassured by the way that Chris was in the next bed to me and we were able to read that psalm together. I think it's quite amazing, the wonderful hand of God watching over us and keeping us safe in many ways. And you reflect back on these things in your life. How do these things happen? And when you do have fearful, difficult times, go to the Word of God, and it helps us. And in fact, the Queen Elizabeth has a lot of memories for me, because I wasn't baptized, and we got married, and my eldest daughter, my first daughter rather, was about to be born at the Queen Elizabeth. And I felt completely helpless in the waiting room, and I was the only one on my own. And I got down on my knees and I prayed to God and said, God, if you deliver my wife and child safely, I will make a determined effort to read the Bible and find out whether you exist or not. And I made that vow to God in prayer. Anyway, about an hour later, the nurse came and said, your wife's about to have the baby now, you better come down. So we were born of our daughter, Elizabeth, baby girl. And of course, the word Elizabeth means by an oath of God. Mm. Which is what I'd done in the waiting room. Mm. And I fulfilled my vow and I read the Bible. And 9 months and one day after she was born, I was baptized at our meeting at Kingsley. And for me, that was my new birth. Wow. And what I'd like to express is how you can be strengthened by going to God, you know, either read his word or go to him in prayer, and the answers to life will appear and you can feel reassured. We had some introductory music played a few minutes ago, and it's called Allegri. Now, he was apparently a monk in the Vatican, and he composed this music, and I heard it. I've never been really keen on church choral music. My wife's a fan, but it's never appealed to me. Being an atheist, I frowned on most of this kind of churchy kind of stuff. Didn't really appreciate it at all. I was more soul man, to be honest, in my generation. The Beatles and one or two other things. And I heard it, but I was drawn to it. It's quite strange. Anyway, about a year later, I was watching a program on BBC Two about Allegri, and the story goes that this monk wrote this piece of music, and the Pope, when he first heard it, this is back in the 12th century or something like that, when he first heard the music, thought it was so wonderful that it would only be played in the Sistine Chapel. It was not to be heard outside the Sistine Chapel, only for the Pope and the court. And a young man called Amadeus Wolfgang Mozart went to listen, and they played this music, and he was so thrilled with it himself that he recorded it note by note from memory, and they played it. Anyway, they played it outside the Vatican, so it was all before the Pope, and Mozart gave a good account of himself and said, look, you know, this is wonderful music. The world should hear this. You know, the word of God should be heard by everybody and not just in the four walls of the Sistine Chapel. And the Pope agreed. And that's why we now have that music. But the haunting thing is, when I first, they gave an introductory talk about this. And then they played the music. And when the music came up, it had subtitles because it was sung in Latin. And it was Psalm 51. Mm. So when I'm driving in my car, or whenever I feel low in my house and thinking that challenging times are again facing me, I put on this Miserere Dei and listen to the voice of God, keep me calm and comforting me all over again. Well, I hope that's been of some benefit to you. It certainly benefited me in my life. And I just hope we can get some kind of extra comfort and encouragement from the Word of God. Thank you.
Fantastic. No, very powerful story. Thank you very much for sharing that with us and how the Word of God has been helpful for you in your life.
Yeah, I found two things really powerful when you were talking, Trev, about that. I think the first one, I think you mentioned it in your opening comment about how, you know, the Psalms can mean different things to us when we're reading them. And, you know, you reflected on how we're all sinful, but there wasn't a particular sin that you were confessing over here. But the moment that you were in, when you were going through that extremely challenging time in your life, this psalm, when you went through those verses about the clean heart aspect, which is, you know, what you were hoping for at the end of this, it just really came to life in how that really resonated with you. And hopefully, you know, anyone who's watching, perhaps when they're reading different psalms, they can definitely relate to some of the challenges that we all go through in our own lives. And I think as well, what I also found really fascinating is how you said you felt, you know, you were turning on your bed in the hospital, you felt really low. And normally that is when we go to God, when we feel low. And I'd say on a sort of a percentage level, Phil, the Psalms that we've looked at have been at times when David's felt low, you know, he's turned to God, he's gone to God in prayer, he's created this psalm for God, you know, through inspiration. And I think that's really powerful as well, that when we are in these times where we're distressed, when we're feeling low, we're feeling challenged, you know, what I think the Psalms are teaching us is we've got God, as you said, he's got the answers, and he's the one that we can turn to. So I found those two points personally really powerful when you were sharing that reflection.
Great.
There are a couple of other Psalms that relate to David's feelings here. Psalm 32, and I think the other one is Psalm 38, and David does mention that he lay on his bed at night, tossing and turning, unable to sleep, and that really is what we find, that David couldn't come to terms until Nathan had come to him and all was revealed. And then when it was revealed, David opened up his heart then. And God knew what was within David's heart, and things took a change for the better from that moment onwards. Let me try and find it. Psalm 32 is about happy is and blessed is the man that now finds out that God has forgiven his sin.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking even in Psalm 32, verse 3, it says, "When I kept silence, my bones waxed old, though my roaring all the day long. For thy day and by night, thy hand was heavy upon me."
Mm-hmm.
You know, David felt depressed because of what was happening.
Yeah.
And I just found that is quite incredible, his feelings at that moment in time. He also then has dreams about the arrows hitting Uriah. You know, because he gave the message to Joab, advance the army forward, and when they're going forward, tell everybody to step back, and Uriah's going to take the full attack of the arrows. Mm. And he talks about that he feels the arrows in him. Again, that verse 4 of chapter 38, "For mine iniquities are gone over my head, as a heavy burden they are too heavy for me. My wounds stink and are corrupt because of my foolishness." This is, again, how he feels about that. Now, you look at verse 2, and this is how it goes. He says, "For thine arrows stick fast in me, and my hand presseth me sore."
Mm.
Why the arrows? Because those are the arrows. And it just shows you how David, this was, you know, nightmares going through David's mind, and for months he must have gone like this until God had thought time enough, and he sent Nathan to say to David, "You've been through enough now." But it's having the openness of the heart to let God's word teach us and make us realize that we're wrong. Back in that Psalm 51, in verse 6, it says, "Behold, you delight in truth, in the inward being. You teach me wisdom in the secret heart." Well, that secret heart has to be us. And it's us in our relationship with God that we learn about that, isn't it? It's not for the crowd. It's for us and God to experience something together. And God has been delighted in the truth of David recognizing his sin.
Mm.
He recognizes it and tells, you know, I shouldn't have done this. And completely opens his heart up to God. And God then blesses David and forgives him, you know. And he calls David a man after my own heart because he opens up. And that's what God wants us to do. God wants us to open up when we've done wrong and when we're in times of difficulty. Then God will help us and he'll teach us wisdom through his word to help us through the difficult and challenging times we face.
And I think a lovely verse just to finish with that really, I was trying to find it when you were speaking, Trev, how you said you read that psalm before your operation and you shut your Bible and you went fast asleep. And in Psalm 4, verse 8, which we looked at a long time ago with Steve, It says, "In peace I will both lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety." And I just thought that was a lovely verse to sort of conclude with that, you know, was definitely comforting for you when you'd thought about how God was with you. And for any of us who are in these really challenging times or whatever we're going through, if like David and like yourself, we go to God, he can help us to dwell in safety and be at peace.
Yeah, as I've already mentioned, that baby girl that was born just over 40 years ago, sadly, passed away from cancer. But she was strong in her courage and her belief all the way through. And I remember when she first came to tell us, we were at home and she came down the drive with her husband. And I know because later on his father said to us, they were felt terrible having to tell us that she'd got terminal cancer. And it was one of the worst days of my life because she told her mom and she were in tears. And then we rang the next daughter. She came, she told her she was in tears. Then daughter number three came. She told her she was a nurse. She was in tears. Number four came. She told her she was in tears. And it was awful. And I hugged my daughter and I said, "Liz, I don't know if God will save you at this moment in time from the disease. But I do know he will resurrect you. And through no matter what may happen to us, God will resurrect us. And then we'll all be together for eternity. And this is just a phase that we have to go through. We're all going to die. Just sadly, you're dying much younger than you anticipated."
Mm.
But it hasn't stopped my belief. That belief, even though I suffered the loss of my daughter, and of course, we just mentioned my granddaughter has got a brain tumor.
Mm.
Even that, I don't turn around and curse God and say, "What have you done for me?" These are things that happen in life. You know, this is what happens to the human being. We suffer from illnesses, COVID, whatever. You know, we're going to die from something or other. But God has said, no matter what will happen to you, I will resurrect you.
Mm.
You know, and that's the most important thing to keep us through life's problems.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Wow. So thank you again so much, Trevor, for joining us, and thank you everyone who's watched this video. We hope it's encouraged you like it's encouraged us as we've considered this psalm and Trevor's thoughts around it. So thank you for watching, and we hope you enjoy the next videos that we have in this series, God willing. Till next time, God bless.
God bless.